Good morning and welcome to Whitefish Bay United Methodist Church. I'm Steve Lyerly and I invite you to join us this morning in our song, The River.
I know a place.
I know a place where we can go to lay the troubles down, even your soul. I know a place where mercy flows, thinks you things make you whiter than snow. Like a tide is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Whoa, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water. Rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river. I see it move in my own life. Took me from dusty roads into paradise. All of my dirt, all of my shame, drowning streams that have made me born again. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water. Rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river.
You will never be the same.
We're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water. Rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river.
Down to the river.
Let's go down, down, down to the river.
Please join me in the call to worship. Open our ears, O God.
That we might hear you when we pray.
Open our ears, O God.
That we might serve you.
Open our ears, O God.
That we might hear your words speaking to us in the morning.
Open our ears, O God.
That we might listen for your voice calling to us through Scripture.
Open our hearts, O God. Amen.
As for me.
As for me, God came and found me. As for me, he took me home. As for me, he gave me a family, and I'll never walk in my life. I'm soaked in blessing, and in heaven there's a great reward. As for me and my house, we're gonna serve the Lord. I've got Jesus, Jesus. He calls me for his own, and he lifts me above the world I know. There is no doubt. God is in the house to keep it.
You may be seated. Good morning. My name is Matt Hadley, and I am the senior pastor of the Church of Whitefish Bay. We have some ushers who are going to be coming forward with our attendance cards. We hope that you will register your attendance so we can pay attention to this important so we can identify who maybe has been away for a while so we can reach out in concern. Today is a special day. You can see some people wearing their scout uniforms, and we are excited for all of the scouting ministries that have taken place and are taking place here with our facility and our resources. Just by a show of hands, how many of you used to be a scout of any kind? Lots of us used to be scouts. So you're going to see them, and there's some displays out in the narthex that you can take a look at and help to support. We gave you your joy notes on the way in. There's a couple things I want to really draw your attention to. Following service today, if you want to go downstairs to our fellowship hall, we have a farmer's market that's down there, a winter farmer's market. So if you want some fresh things, be sure to stop downstairs. They have all kinds of goodies there for you. And today is a new display in our art gallery, the 29th annual Lifetime Art Exhibition. And there's going to be a reception in there today. And all of the artists are 50 plus in their ages. So you see what they can do with all of their wisdom and years of experience in expressing themselves through a variety of mediums. Well, you heard a different voice in our call to worship today, and that was the voice of Steve Lyerly. He's just a good old Boy Scout. Emphasis on the old part of Scout. And Steve is new on staff with us as of February the 1st. And is going to, he's just kind of working very part-time right now. He's going to ramp it up a little bit starting June 1st, working with our young people and right. their families. But Steve, tell people what you're doing right now full-time. What's your full-time gig?
My full-time job is with the Boy Scouts of America. I am the development director. So when someone asks you for money, I told them to go do that.
Wow. That's a fun job.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. My friends see me coming, and they walk away. Anyway, thank you for letting us come in and talk about Scouts a little bit today. First of all, I'd like to introduce you to Larry Danner. If you would stand up, please. Larry is our Larry is the district executive director, senior district executive, something like that, for the Polaris District, which encompasses most of the North Shore over to up in Brown Deer. Quite a big area, and he oversees all the scouting programs in that area, so that's why he's here this morning. He relates to Troop 400 and the other packs and troops in this area. So I get asked all the time when I go out to talk about scouting, people say, what's going on with scouting? We never hear about scouting anymore unless it's in the news. And I say, it's funny you say that, because scouting is happening all the time, but it happens in church basements, it happens in school gymnasiums, in VFW halls, in places that you don't normally see, and the scouts don't always wear their uniform when they're out doing their projects and their good deeds and such. So people, you think they're not seeing the scouts, and they probably are. I was handed this list. This is Troop 400's, just Troop 400's list of things they have coming up. It's a big list, and I don't have the time to share it all with you, but I encourage you to stop by the displays and find out what the scouts are doing. Now, at this time, I'm actually going to invite all the kids to come down front and join me for the children's time. Come down front. Come on, everybody. I promise we're going to have fun. While they're coming down, are there any Eagle Scouts in the room? Please stand and be recognized. Thank you very much. All right, fantastic. I tell you what, I'm going to talk a little bit about scouts today, and I see we have some scouts here with us today. That is awesome, and both Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. You know, you're going to see the scouts do a lot of really neat, fun things, but one of my favorite things that the scouts do is go camping. How many of you like to go camping? I love to go camping. When we're out camping, we go hiking, we go swimming, we go boating, we work on crafts, But my very most favorite thing to do when I'm camping is sit around the campfire. How many of you like to sit around the campfire and cook up some hot dogs? I can eat 5 hot dogs. How many can you eat? Who can eat more than 5 hot dogs? 10 hot dogs? Oh my gosh, that's a lot of hot dogs. Can you eat 10 too? Can you eat 10? 4 hot dogs? How many? 40? Wow. And then after we eat our hot dogs, we make those things, what are they called, with the graham crackers and marshmallows and chocolate? Yeah, s'mores. And you bite into them and the marshmallow smushes all over your face and you go, oh no, my fingers are stuck to my face. And then after we eat our s'mores, we like to sit around the campfire and tell stories. That's right. You know, the campfire is kind of important because it keeps us warm, doesn't it? And we can cook our food. But did you know we also have fire in the church? Where can you find fire in the church? Anybody know? Absolutely right. Right up there at the candles. Anybody know why we do the candles? Well, there are lots of reasons. It provides warmth. Mostly it provides light. It represents when Jesus said, don't light your candle and put it under a bushel basket because you can't see it. We want people to see the light. And Jesus is the light for us in our work in the world, in our lives in the world. Also, you remember that story where Moses saw the burning bush? That's another one in the Bible. Fire is very important. But you know what? I brought my campfire book. Can I read you something real quick out of my campfire book? Would you like that? We call it the campfire book because we like to sit around the campfire and read the campfire. Whoa! There's a campfire in my book. Where did that come from? Would you like to know the secret of the campfire book? I sure you do. But if you want to know the secret, you got to join Scouts. How's that sound? And you are a Scout. All right, you know what? Let's bow our heads and pray. I want to make a deal with you, though. I want you guys to start the prayer. I'll do the real long middle part, and then you guys do the end where you say amen. So I want you guys to do the Dear God, and then I'll do the middle part. And then you all do the amen at the end, all right? Are you ready? I'm going to count to 3. 1, 2, 3. Dear God, thank you for this wonderful time together that we can come to your house and worship you, but also learn about you and your Bible and the love of Jesus in our lives. We thank you for programs for young people, for youth and children that bring us together and teach us good values like respect and responsibility and always telling the truth. We also give thanks for the fire, whether it's on the candles or the campfire or keeping us warm or lighting our way. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, God, for my family. I know they love me so. They teach me all about your word, and they guide me as I grow. We go to church together. We worship and we pray. One of your grace
Let us now have a time of silent and listening prayer. Thank you for the gift of singing. Let us pray together. God of abundant mercy, God of abundant life, and God of abundant grace, you are holy, you are mighty, and you are great. We give you thanks as a family gathered here present this morning. Lord, we give you thanks for being present among us. We give you thanks for giving us the opportunity to come and worship you in this place. As a family, Lord, we are not counting only on the biological family. Lord, we know that we have adopted family. We have foster family. We have the Christian family right here and around the world. Lord, as we remember those who are struggling with different things, we remember to give you thanks. We remember to give you thanks for your love. We remember to give you thanks for your mercy. And we remember to give you thanks for you are with us all the time. In good time and in bad times, you are present. As a family, we want to commit to the people who are here present and those who are not present here because they are part of this large family. Lord, we remember to thank you for a husband who just found a new job. God, we thank you for a new job opportunity for someone else and a friend. God, we continue to call upon your name because some of our friends are not in good spirits right now, and we know that you are present in their difficult times right now. We remember a young father and husband this final week battling a brain tumor. May his family find peace and comfort. Papa, prayer for healing for all those struggling in the world. Prayers for those in poverty. And we remember those with any health issues, cancer, diabetics, heart problems, ALS, mental and arthritis. Prayer for Anne, our daughter, who suffers from mental illness. Prayer for Maddie, a little girl going through chemo. Lord, prayer for my daughter and I, reconnect, forgive, and love. Lord Jesus, prayer for this young mother who is in need of double lung transplants so that she can get back on her feet and continue to worship you as she requires. Lord, we continue to give you thanks and praise for our scouts around the world who are serving places that some people are not able to see what they do, but we connect with the scouts who come to this place, Lord. We remember those who are at home not able to send us their prayer requests, Lord. Remember their need. And we continue to praise your name because you are our Father. And we remember the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not in temptation, but forgive us from evil. Thy is the kingdom, the power. Amen.
Ushers, come forward to collect today's tithes and offerings.
Oh, I've heard thousand stories dead of night and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, it's love, so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still you call me. Deeper still into love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, who you are, who you are. I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am. And you're a good, good father. It's who you are.
Sing with us.
It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good father.
Who you are, who you are, who you are.
And I'm loved by you.
You are perfect in all of your ways. Who I am, who I am.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the gifts that we have received from you and the gifts that we can now offer up. For the blessings that we have, we are grateful. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Well, today we're going to conclude our sermon series on I Have a Friend Who. And in this sermon series, we've been exploring how we can be the kind of friend that God needs us to be so that we can help build one another up. We know we are stronger because of our friends. And so we have taken a look at our friends who are different from us. Maybe they're different because they have a different sexual orientation, or they're from a different place, or their politics are different from us, their sense of humor is different. Maybe they're even Cub fans. How do we be a good friend to them? We continued by taking a look at our friends who don't believe in God. And they maybe look at us and say, how in the world do we believe in God? We took a look at how we can be a friend to those friends that we have that are struggling with addiction or struggling with issues of depression. Just last week, we had Jerry, Pastor Jerry, gave us a sermon looking at our friends who gossip. And we've been talking about that sermon all week long. If you've missed any of those, they're all on our webpage. You can catch the audio there. But today we end with, I have a friend who wants a family. And as Young Haven sang so beautifully, there are all kinds of different kinds of families. No two families look alike. Not all families are biological. But when you ask someone, what do you think of when you think of family? All kinds of things come to mind. I saw a clip on YouTube this week, and you know they were out. What comes to mind when you think of family? And they said things like love and unity. Family is a precious gift, not to be taken for granted. Family is being there for each other, supporting and taking care of each other on a journey together. Family is honesty and forgiveness. Family is a safe and comfortable place to be. Family is where we can be genuine, not having to wear a mask. And one person said in this clip, family is eternal. It is forever. But I know that if someone stuck a microphone in somebody else's face, maybe in your face, and said, what do you think of when you think of family? Maybe you would say dysfunction. Maybe you would say guilt. Maybe you would say pain. Maybe you would say abandonment. Family can be lots of different things. But no one here would say family is salvation. That just is not something that we would say. But in the Old Testament, there was this belief that a woman would be saved through what? Through childbirth. And what kind of childbirth? Through sons. I'm so in love with my wife, Janet. 25 years we're celebrating this summer, but her soul is going to hell because she only had these... Well, we know now that's the man's part of the equation, but there was this belief that you had to have sons to be saved. And so there's this wonderful story. It's a story of some pain, actually, from 1 Samuel. And the main character in this story is a woman named Hannah. And Hannah is married to a man named Elkanah. And Hannah and Elkanah are married at a time and in a place where you could have multiple wives. So there was also Peninnah. I'm just going to call it Elk and Penny. So Elk, Penny, and Hannah are a family, you would think. The problem is, Penny is having children. She is providing sons for Elkanah, for Elk. And Penny is starting to bully Hannah. What's the matter? Oh, aren't you pregnant? Ooh. You know, just all kinds of mean things. Just really being horrible to her. And Hannah is so distraught that she can't even eat. And so Elk, being a typical man, men have always been men, Elk comes along and says, oh, come on, honey, aren't I more valuable to you than 10 sons? He just doesn't get it. She can't eat, so he tries to give her more food. She still can't eat, and she's distraught. And so when you're distraught, when life is terrible, she does what we should all do. She goes to a house of prayer. And she goes in and she prays. And as she's praying, she's kind of rocking and she's moving her mouth, but no words are coming out. That looks crazy. And so the priest comes in, Eli, and he sees this happening, and he thinks a drunk person has just come off the street and is in there. And so he goes up and, you know, tries to come down on her for being drunk and in public. You know, what a disgrace, and in the house of the Lord. And she explains herself. She explains herself. And so we have just a couple verses, starting with verse 17. Then Eli the priest answered, go in peace. The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him. And she said, let your servant find favor in your sight. Then the woman went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and her countenance was sad no longer. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. Elkanah knew his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son, and she named him Samuel, for she said, I have asked him of the Lord. The words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Hannah is so appreciative, she dedicates this son, Samuel, to the Lord's service. It's interesting, for Hannah, family was not having a husband or having a household. No, for Hannah, family was just having this son, having a child. What is family? There's all different kinds of families. We have many friends and family members who are single and who want to be single. They have no desire to be in a relationship with anybody. And they say they have family, so family has to be more than just being married or having children. And yet we have other friends who are almost desperate in their want of a spouse or a mate or a partner that can produce for them. So what are we looking at here really? When a friend comes up to us and says, I want a family, they're probably saying one of two things. One, I want a tight-knit, close group of people. Or they're saying, I want to get married, have a partner, I want to have a child, maybe if they're already married. Now, we're going to talk about all this, and if you are a single person here, we're going to talk directly to you a little bit later in this sermon. But let's look at these, because these are both deep human instincts that have power over us. They surge, this instinct surges through us, and sometimes we do things that we're not even consciously aware of. And so social scientists have been studying this, these various groups that act as family when there is no real family present. When a traditional family is non-existent, individuals will instinctively try and group up. It turns out Cheers was right. We really do want a place where everybody knows your name. Or we think about the most popular sitcom on TV right now, Big Bang Theory. Family of origin is mocked. It is that our family for one another. But when we look at this instinct, we start to understand gangs a little bit, don't we? In our inner cities, there are all of these children who are being brought into this gang because that gang provides for them family. You know, we had 190 people in this sanctuary on Wednesday night to watch 53206, that documentary about the most incarcerated zip code in the nation, which is right here in Milwaukee. And one of the things that we followed in that was a man who was talking basically to gangbangers in jail, telling them how to be the father that they have never known before. And so these gangs, they incorporate people by having this sense of family, and this family sense is so strong that they're willing to die for one another. The unfortunate thing is evil is being perpetrated. Or think about the family community that social media has provided. Many of us have friends or family members that are introverts or maybe socially awkward, and yet social media, it gives people an opportunity to have community, gives people to have a sense of family, and yet there's danger there too because of all the online predators that exist. We need to create communities that can be family, that are life-giving, and that's where the church needs to come in. The United Methodist Church says, community provides the potential for nurturing human beings into the fullness of their humanity. And we believe that we have a responsibility to innovate, sponsor, and evaluate new forms of community that will encourage development of the fullest potential. Church as family. You go to a lot of churches and they call each other brother and sister all the time. At my last church, the church I served for 14 years, there was a young couple, and they came from an impossibly small little place in Iowa. I mean, nothing but corn and animals and just this little town with this little group of people. And because of work, they were relocated. Now they found themselves in Slinger, Wisconsin, no family. And they started to have their own children, and they were lost. They were drawn to church. Their church became their family. The connections that they have in that community of faith, those are the people that they spend Thanksgiving with. Those are the people that they celebrate birthdays with, baptisms with, life events. We are a family here, and we need to continue to do everything we can to nourish and nurture that. Belonging, family connection, and community are so important. Touch is important. There's a reason why all the clergy stand in back and shake everyone's hand on the way out. We know that primates that don't get touch shrivel up and die. But if you have a friend that says, I want a family, what they're probably saying to you is they want a relationship. They want to get married, or they want to have children. And even if this is not your desire, your friend needs you to be supportive and listening to them. The truth is, we have been created to belong, and we are animal at our nature. And did you know that the female animal and the male animal are different? Can I get an amen? Thank God for that. You know, when scientists study the human male, they see that we are not unlike other male animals. This is what they say. The human male applies criteria typical for any male animal. He has a drive to impregnate as many females as possible, to create as many offspring with his genes as possible. He looks for women who are impregnable, instincts, friends, that need to be kind of kept in control. But women are different, much different kind of animal, much different kind of animal. The human female is unlike any other female animal. She does not go into heat and mate with the closest best bet. She makes plans, examines her choices, makes conscious decisions. Only the human female can make conscious, planned decisions about her sex life. She desires to reproduce, but not with just any animal that comes along. The more I study this, the more a miracle it is that Janet said yes to me. To me, what God is good all the time. Now, I need to acknowledge that there are exceptions. Not all women, children, not all men run around trying to get anything that walks pregnant. It just doesn't work that way. But this drive is at the core of humanity. I can't tell you how many weddings I have done where it is obvious to me that the main reason that this wedding is happening is because somebody is starting to feel their biological clock tick, and they are afraid that time is running out. Now, I want to come back to the people who are single, who don't have children. For our many friends and for our family members that are single, we might be the problem. You and I might be the problem. Pressure. We treat our single friends differently, and we need to repent from that. Grown men coming home having to sit at the children's table at Thanksgiving because they don't have a family of their own. Viewing somebody as not fully having been grown up because they're not married yet. I'll never forget, I was driving with my niece and nephew. They were about 2.5 or 3 years old, and I had been dating this girl all of their conscious life. And they said, you know, Uncle Matt, we've been thinking, it's about time that you and she get married. 3 years old. Where had she heard that? Well, because obviously some family gathering that I was not at, that was the topic of conversation, that it was time for Pastor Matt to grow up and to get married to this girl. Ways in which we hurt our single friends. How difficult society might even be. Every form you fill out, you have to check a box. No box defines you. Do you apply pressure? Are you looking for somebody? When do you think you're going to settle down? When you're at a wedding, do you say, go on up there and try and catch the bouquet or catch the garter? When you're at a wedding, do you say, well, are you next? When is it your turn? We wouldn't say that at a funeral. Why do we do it at weddings? We need to be careful. But I want to come back to where I started. I want to come back to Hannah. As I mentioned, because of the dynamics, Hannah was unable to see those people that she was doing life with as family. For her, it needed to be a son. She needed that child. And there are maybe some of you in this sanctuary or listening online that know all too well that kind of pain. Maybe that's a pain that is no longer even relevant, or maybe it's a pain that you're going through right now. For many people, Valentine's Day, which is this Tuesday, is a difficult day. But at the church I served in Elkhorn, this little church, there was this fantastic young couple, both attorneys, educated givers, godly people. And every Mother's Day, the tradition in that little church was at children's time, we didn't have a book that burst into flames like Steve had, but on Mother's Day, all the children would come and take flowers and present a flower to every woman, young or old, in the entire sanctuary. And every year, this woman who thought she could make it through would stand up and run out of the sanctuary in tears. Poor girl. Every year she thought, I can make it through this year. You see, for them, getting pregnant, conception was not the issue. It was taking a pregnancy full term. And she and I would talk about it, and she said, you know, I don't like myself right now, which is a terrible thing to have to get to the point to say that. I don't like myself right now, she would say, because I'm looking at some of these other people that are having kid after kid after kid with multiple partners and one. I don't like thinking that way. Starting to question God's justice, doubting it. I have other friends that have spent tens of thousands of dollars to hope that science might help them have this child and only to have nothing. There is a real pain, and we need to be a godly presence in that life, which means we need to not talk so much and be present and let them know how much we love them, how much we understand the pain that they are going through. Adoption route. Thank God for foster parents. Thank God for adoptive parents that give children wonderful homes to grow up in. But friends, what I want us to understand is that whether we are married or single, we here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay are family, brothers and sisters. We raise each other's children. We celebrate life's events with one another. And so, dear friends, when we look at our brothers and sisters who are longing for a different kind of family, love them, even if their longing is not your longing. Love them and let them know that we are lifting them up in prayers. Love them being sensitive to their pain. Love them by listening and more than talking. Love them, for we are all family in Christ. Amen. And so at this time, I invite our praise band to come back into place. And why don't we stand as we are willing and able as we continue worshiping God by singing, As For Me and My...
Today I choose.
Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live. Today me and my house, we will serve.
eternal King, Lord of hosts, willingly.